Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to our next Experts on Air webinar. My name is Caroline Brown from Hamilton Medical, and today our experts will talk about something that's been touched on by other speakers in this series, namely mechanical power. We're very pleased to have as our speaker today the author of some of the studies cited in the previous webinars, Laura Buiteman from Amsterdam. And Laura is joined by a very familiar face in this series, Professor Giorgio Iotti from Italy. Just in case you're watching for the first time, please note your cameras and microphones are switched off, but you can ask as many questions as you like using the Q&A function. The session is being recorded and we'll send out a link to the recording by email later next week. But now it's time for me to hand over to our interviewer for today, Professor Giorgio Iotti. Thank you, Giorgio.
Thank you, Caroline, for the introduction. I am Giorgio Iotti, former professor of anesthesiology at the University of Pavia and head of ICU at the Hospital of Pavia. Today, I am the interviewer of Laura Buiteman, who has already been a speaker at Experts on Air. Laura is a ventilation practitioner and ICU nurse at the Heiner de Graaf Hospital in Delft, in the Netherlands. Laura is working at her PhD on mechanical ventilation that is planned to be finished by the end of the year at the Amsterdam University Medical Centers. And the main topic of her research is closed loop control ventilation and also mechanical power. So I think Laura is the idea speaker for the topic of today, which I think is very interesting because the ventilation, automatic ventilation modes of Hamilton were conceived some years before, or even many years before anybody paid attention and had the idea of the importance of mechanical power. Yes, and so we welcome the attendance. Me and Laura welcome the attendance. And we would like to start with the traditional polls of experts on air. The first one is, what is mechanical power? What you do in your practice? You don't use at all mechanical power because you think that at the moment is just a tool for researchers, or sometimes you pay attention to mechanical power or frequently. Please start with your answers.
I'm very curious to the answers.
Yes, to see the answers.
Yeah, because it's quite new and quite difficult sometimes. So I'm wondering what people... if people will use it and how often.
Yes, we must say that at the moment the technology does not help to consider mechanical power in the clinical practice.
Oh, but no, it's all manually calculated.
It's all manually calculated.
Yeah.
So here we see the answers. So they has been all manually calculated sometimes, and I think that sometimes for more than 50% is already an interesting result, because
it's true
that probably the who answered to the title of the present webinar had already an interest on mechanical power.
But
that's important. And now we have a second poll also based on which can be what's new in mechanical power. It's about the respiratory rate. So what is the highest respiratory rate setting that you would use to control arterial PCO2 in adult ARDS? Maximum 20 or 24 or 28 or 30 or no limit? please go ahead. And here we are. Okay, let's say fairly high for the majority. 28, 30, or even no limit. We imagine that it does not mean 60, no limit, but it's even more than 30.
More than 30.
Even more than 30.
Yeah.
That's fine. Maybe that after the discussion and that Laura is starting to the presentation and Laura is starting now, maybe that something could change in that. So please, Laura, go ahead with your presentation.
I would like to thank Giorgio for the very nice introduction of me. And of course, also thanks to Hamilton Medical for the introduction for the invitation to speak again during this nice webinar series. I will talk about my favorite topics. This is my disclosure. And today I have the pleasure to discuss the following things with you. I will share some knowledge about the background of mechanical power. And we also know mechanical power as energy, or sometimes called as intensity of mechanical ventilation. And then I will speak further about closed loop ventilation. And of course, more specific, adaptive support ventilation and IntelliVent adaptive support ventilation, which is the successor of ASV. And this will follow by some study results and also some discussion points. So we all know the importance of lung protective ventilation to prevent the development of ventilator-induced lung injury. And well, that's what we do when we, during our daily practice, when we take care of our patients, because during mechanical ventilation, we pay attention to several key elements. And these key elements are the tidal volume, the respiratory rate, all the ventilation pressures, like the driving pressure, the peak pressures, PEEP, and the mechanical power is the summary variable of these key elements. It is the amount of energy transferred from the ventilator to the respiratory system. And this energy is necessary to overcome the airway resistance and to expand the chest wall, to actually ventilate the lungs and to make sure there is gas exchange. But too much energy can act directly on lung tissue and can cause lung injury. So the higher the amount of mechanical power, the higher the amount of energy going through the lungs, the worse it can be for the lung tissue. Mechanical power can be calculated directly from waveforms, from the ventilator waveforms, but mostly nowadays it's calculated with an equation, with a formula. And it's expressed in joule per minute. And as you might know, because there are a lot of people in the audience having some experience with mechanical power, so as you might know, there are many, many equations proposed in the literature and many equations available, suitable for volume-controlled ventilation or pressure-controlled ventilation. And the one I show here is just an example, because it's probably the most easy to explain the underlying theory of mechanical power, because it shows nicely which elements of mechanical ventilation are included. And until now, it's also the most often used in research. But note, this is only an example of the equation. And the illustration on the right shows the complexity of the framework of mechanical power, and that mechanical power depends on two factors, lung-related factors and ventilation-related factors. Lung-related factors include the size of the baby lung in ARDS lungs and, for example, the degree of heterogeneity. So how sick the lung is actually, the underlying pulmonary condition. And ventilation-related causes is how we, as ICU nurses, as doctors, as respiratory therapists, how we set the ventilator and how we balance all the key settings. Mechanical power is associated with outcomes like mortality. This was a large prospective cohort study with quite some patients, performed in Canada, and it was published, already 3 years ago in The Lancet. But they show very nicely that with a mechanical power above 17 joules per minute, which is the purple line in the figure, that with that cutoff of 17 joules per minute, there is a higher mortality. Mechanical power is also associated with other outcomes like ventilator-free days and ICU and hospital length of stay. This was a large IPD meta-analysis performed in two American ICU databases, and it shows an association with ICU and 30-day mortality and also ventilator-free days. Also, again, with the cutoff of 17 joules per minute, because the safety cutoff is then lower than 17 joules. And there are quite some other examples of recent studies available, wherein you can say that it is important to ventilate with less energy. But ventilating with less energy at all times with a lower mechanical power, is a challenging task, because it's not only difficult and complex, maybe it's also impractical and very time consuming, because you need to be at the bedside very often, calculating after every change of the ventilator settings. So I wonder if it's even possible to ventilate with less energy at all times when you set the ventilator manually, because you want to balance all the settings at all times. So one solution could be the use of automated or closed loop ventilation. And automated ventilation might sound like a new way for mechanical ventilation in ICU patients, but actually the opposite is true, because the first mode, including closed loop principles, was already developed in 1992. And several modes followed. Of course, during this lecture, I will focus only on ASV and IntelliVent ASV. ASV selects automatically, based on a set minute volume by the user, the tidal volume and the respiratory rate, based on the lowest work of breathing, according to the equation of Otis. I think this is already discussed during the previous lectures, as well as the working mechanism of IntelliVent ASV, which adds several more algorithms during mechanical ventilation, including the lowest force of breathing, according to the principle of Meat. And IntelliVent ASV, as we all know, performs automated titrations of tidal volume, respiratory rate, PEEP, and FiO2 by means of the measured and tidal CO2 and SpO2. And during this lecture on this webinar, I will not focus on PEEP and the FiO2, but I will share the findings of the effect of the automated selections of tidal volume and respiratory rate. So as Caroline said during her introduction, my studies are already cited sometimes at the previous webinars, which is of course an honor, but I think I can focus some more on on the results and on the purposes, because this was my first study of my PhD. And this studied the ventilator settings 2 months directly before the implementation of ASV in my ICU and 2 months directly after the implementation. It was just a small observational study with 24 patients who were passively ventilated. And it served as the pilot study for the IntelliPower randomized clinical trial. IntelliPower is a quite large international randomized clinical trial, a crossover study, and this will study the effects of IntelliVent ASV in a randomized setting. But this study of ASV shows some nice first results, which gave us quite some insight. The figures on the right are distribution plots, and the lines are cumulative from the lowest to the highest value, and it shows the median value. And red is conventional ventilation and blue represents ASV. And the more space between the lines, the more difference there is. So here we see no difference in tidal volume, as already also indicated with the p-value. There was also not a difference in driving pressure, which can be explained by the small amount of patients. But we see a clear difference in the respiratory rate, which is on the right top of the figures, because there's a large difference between the two lines. And the result of a lower respiratory rate is a lower mechanical power. So what you can see at the figure is that almost 80% of the patients is ventilated under 17 joules per minute with ASV, compared to 50% under 17 joules per minute with conventional ventilation. Well, there was no other difference what we saw, but with the small amount of the patients included in the study, we need to be careful, of course, to draw conclusions. But for this first small observational study, it was, of course, a first signal of our interest. This was a quite recent published study in respiratory care from the research group in Boston. It was also a randomized crossover study. It included 17 patients, and the crossover was from adaptive pressure ventilation to ASV and vice versa, of course. And what you see here is that the use of ASV is associated with the individual titration of tidal volume. Because when compliance increases, so when compliance improves, which you can see on the x-axis, on both of the figures, the tidal volume is also increasing, meaning that when compliance got worse, tidal volume is changed by ASV by lowering the tidal volume. So it really, in the individual titrates, the size of the tidal volume. So this is another study from my hand. We studied the conversion from conventional pressure-controlled ventilation to IntelliVent ASV, 2 and 1 hour before implantation and 1 and 2 hours after conversion from conventional ventilation to IntelliVent ASV. And this was in 51 patients with COVID-19 ARDS. It was a pre-planned sub-study of the PROVENT COVID study, which was a large observational study during the first 3 months of the pandemic in the Netherlands. So really at the early stage of the pandemic, it was performed in 2 centers. The patients were without spontaneous breathing activity, and the patients were quite ill because 86 met the criteria of a moderate or severe ARDS. And what I show here again with the distribution plots, with 4 lines this time representing the 1 and 2 hour after conversion and the 2 and 1 hour before conversion. So what we show here is that we saw a slightly increase in tidal volume. With the blue lines, the tidal volume is a little bit larger with IntelliVent ASV, but still within the safety limits of 6 to 8 milliliters per kilogram's ideal body weight. But much more remarkable is the large, maybe dramatic decrease of respiratory rate with IntelliVent ASV. The respiratory rate is much, much lower. And that resulted in a slightly lower driving pressure, but again, a large difference with IntelliVent ASV in mechanical power. So a much lower mechanical power with IntelliVent ASV. So that was, of course, very interesting because we did not expect at first that tidal volume would increase a bit. And of course, we were curious when we saw this slightly increase, in which patients and when tidal volume increased, because we also saw that tidal volume sometimes decreased in the individual patients. And although it remained mostly between the safety limits, the tidal volume. We wanted to know, well, what IntelliVent was setting and what the effect was on the driving pressure. And these plots here show, with individual patient data, show the effect of the conversion to IntelliVent. And the positive value above the horizontal line shows an increase of tidal volume. And below the line, it's a decrease of tidal volume when there was a switch from conventional to IntelliVent ASV. And what we see is that conversion to IntelliVent ASV resulted in a decrease in driving pressure, which you can see on the right. It resulted in a decrease in driving pressure most of the time. And what was of most of our interest is that when driving pressure was high with conventional ventilation, VT was later on, the tidal volume was later on decreased with IntelliVent ASV. So here you saw again the individual titration of the ventilation settings of tidal volume. And the results in COVID-19 ARDS are confirmed by others. This is a study from a very active research group in Zurich, which are very experienced with IntelliVent ASV. This was a prospective study. And what they did, they used minute-by-minute data extracted from their patient's management data system. And they allocated patients to the ventilation mode based on the availability of the ventilator. So it was conventional ventilation or IntelliVent ASV. And in this figure, you see tidal volume, respiratory rate at top, and driving pressure and mechanical power below. And it is showed over 7 days. And what you see is that respiratory rate, driving pressure, and mechanical power are lower with IntelliVent ASV as well. So that was nice to see when they published the study. So what we have here is a new study. It's currently under review for publication. And what this is a randomized crossover study in 13 patients. So also a small amount of patients. And it's, well, I think it's a quite nice physiological study. Patients were randomized to start with 4 hours of conventional pressure controlled ventilation or IntelliVent ASV, and they crossed over for another 4 hours to the other mode. And what we did here was we used transpulmonary pressures instead of respiratory system pressures, and that allowed us to reduce the noise that comes from well, the possible increases in the chest wall compliance. So we could determine better the effects of IntelliVent ASV on the lung stress. And what we see here again is also well, a slightly but safe increase in tidal volume. But again, at the top right, again, the large reduction in respiratory rate. And that resulted in a lower transpulmonary driving pressure and a lower transpulmonary mechanical power. So these are some figures, again, from the same study. It shows the same, but more remarkable again is here the respiratory rate, which is in red with conventional ventilation, which is, well, or almost all, everything is around 23 as a median. And with the green dots, with closed loop ventilation, respiratory rate is much lower. And important to say is that there was no difference in gas exchange, so no no differences in entitle or PaCO2. So of course we wondered in which patients the increase in tidal volume took place. First, we hypothesized that the slight increase in tidal volume resulted in recruitment of parts of the lung and that it was sufficient enough to lead to less overinflation and therefore leads to a lower driving pressure. And in the study of Costa and others, which is this figure of, a pooled database of more than 4,000 patients was used to analyze the effect of mechanical power on mortality. But they also show that an increase in tidal volume, which is showed on the x-axis, that a decrease in respiratory rate, which are the black dots, in patients with not so low compliance, which is the blue line, that doesn't affect the driving pressure much, because here you see an increasing tidal volume and a lower respiratory rate, but the driving pressure is not that much different. And this suggests, can maybe suggest, that ventilator strategies with a very low tidal volume and a higher respiratory rate is only beneficial in patients with a very low compliance, as is showed with the red line. There, a driving pressure is already high with low tidal volume, but increases a lot with a larger tidal volume. So that can explain in part the effect of INTELLiVENT ASV on tidal volume. Again, the individual titration, but it's still, well, it's nice to see. So in conclusion, INTELLiVENT ASV is associated with a lower mechanical power, mostly due to a lower respiratory rate and a lower driving pressure. Setting the ventilator variables, the key parameters, and therefore influencing the amount of mechanical power is complex because it requires a very sophisticated balance. If you ask me now which setting of the ventilator decreased the mechanical power the most, you will not be surprised to hear me say that this could be the respiratory rate, because the level of stress and strain delivered with each breath, as reflected by the driving pressure, is important, but also how often this is repeated, as reflected by the respiratory rate. But to know more, our research group in Amsterdam is analyzing a large database now, where we are going to do a kind of a deconvolution of the mechanical power equation to determine which variable or which combination of variables of mechanical ventilation affects mechanical power the most. But to end this lecture, it's all about balancing the ventilation parameters, fitting the lung mechanics of the individual patient. So thank you for your attention, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Laura. So actually, there are interesting questions.
That is nice.
And I will just follow the order, because it's very
all
nice.
Good questions.
Yes, first is Massimo G, who asks, do you use mechanical power calculation in your daily practice? So if yes, how do you do?
No, that's a good question. As mentioned in my lecture, using mechanical power in daily practice is difficult, because when you change the parameter, you want to calculate mechanical power again, and then maybe change another parameter, and then calculating mechanical power again, which is all doing by hand, because there's not a ventilator showing the amount of mechanical power. So I'm not using it as much as I would want to, because, well, it's time consuming, so I don't have all time, all day. But when I adjust a ventilator setting, I always take into account what would be the effect of mechanical power on the mechanical power and what fits the patient best. So I literally stand with the calculator next to the ventilator. But, well, after that, I also need to do my other tasks. So I use it with a calculator, but not as much as I would want to.
And I make a sub question, and how should be the patient for getting the data for the calculation? So passively ventilative or active, or is it irrelevant?
No, it's only possible in passively ventilated patients, because in actively ventilated patients, when the patient is spontaneously breathing, you need to take into account the muscle activity of the patient, and we don't have an equation or a method to do that yet. Of course, that is also of interest, because most patients in clinical practice are breathing spontaneously, but for an accurate amount of mechanical power to measure it, you have to be have a passively ventilated patient without any spontaneous attempts.
The hidden part of the iceberg should be taken into account, but we don't have an easy access. Second important question is from Claire Perpignan. How do ASV and INTELLiVENT reduce mechanical power? And I would ask something more. So especially ASV, but also INTELLiVENT, were conceived much before we intensivists brought our attention to mechanical power. So how mm-hmm. is it possible that there is some effect, some advantage, as yeah. you've shown in repeated studies for mechanical power?
Yeah, I think there's definitely an advantage with closed loop ventilation, as we can see in the study results. And well, first, because IntelliVent and ASV are adjusting the settings 24/7 according to the lung mechanics, much faster as we can as ICU professionals. It's continuously adapting to the patient needs. So that's of course one benefit, and I think one cause that IntelliVent and ASV are reducing mechanical power. And what we also see in the study results is that ASV and IntelliVent ASV are choosing the right balance of the settings. In some patients, you want to increase tidal volume because that fits compliance best. But in other patients, you just want to decrease tidal volume because the compliance is worse.
Which is a little bit the heretic part of the message that we are proposing today, that six may be not always the best.
No, maybe exactly. Not always the best. You know, we are focusing very, very much on the six, but sometimes 6.5, 6.8, maybe 7 even, could be better for the individual patient. Right, Giorgio?
Yes, perfect. Clearly, you have shown how in some cases of each casuistic, it is possible to safely ventilate with a little bit higher tidal volume.
Yep.
And like that, ventilation becomes much more efficient, and you can finally achieve a major reduction of mechanical power through a reduction of respiratory rate, mainly through a reduction.
Yeah, exactly. But it's difficult sometimes.
Not in all patients.
It's difficult to define in which patient you can increase tidal volume and which patients you just need to decrease tidal volume. So that makes it a difficult task.
I think that one of your last slides, the one with the two curves, with for the patient with the better compliance, with the very bad compliance, shows very well this concept.
Yeah, it's a very nice study. Yeah.
Yes, the study by Costa is very nice.
Yeah, by Costa. Yeah.
And anonymous attendee, very important question. What is the role of PEEP in mechanical power delivery? Do you think that the PEEP FiO2 tables could help or not mechanical power?
It's a really relevant question and quite some difficult because, well, of course, what I already told him in lectures, I was only showing the effects of the automation on tidal volume respiratory rate. I did not show PEEP and FiO2. Okay. And there is, something less... results are available about that. I think the role of PEEP is important because an optimal PEEP for the patient can make sure that you have the most optimal compliance possible in the patient. So that's an important thing. Too much or too less PEEP can influence your ventilation and also the mechanical power. I think the PEEP FiO2 tables in reducing mechanical power are not suitable for every patient because it's not that one size or one table fits all. It's really about personalization and individualization, but I'm curious what your opinion is about that, Giorgio. What do you think about that question?
No, I think clearly the PEEP FiO2 tables do not take into account respiratory mechanics, and mechanical power is a matter of mechanics.
Yeah.
So they should be integrated with other information for to achieve, at least to achieve this this kind of function. The anonymous attendee has another interesting question. And if you need to improve, but this is easy for you, if you need to improve CO2 removal while having mechanical power in mind, what would be your recommendation?
Well, first, I will try to determine what's the best size of the tidal volume is for the patient. So if you can be having safe ventilation with maybe a little higher tidal volume, not 10 or 12, but maybe 7 or 6.8. And with that, you can improve your minute volume. But also with that, you can maybe decrease your respiratory rate a bit. So there's more time for your total inspiration, expiration cycle. So that makes the gas exchange more sufficient. You have more sufficient ventilation. But that's really a titration of the individual patient. So it's a tryout. But I will not really increase the respiratory rate very, very much.
Again, Laura, this anonymous attendee, I was convinced that drive impression was more relevant than mechanical power.
It's relevant, of course, as well. So that's why it's also included in the mechanical power equation. Driving pressure is a very, very nice tool because it's the ratio between compliance and tidal volume. So you can titrate the tidal volume, what fits best for the compliance. But mechanical power takes into account all the other settings that we have to set during mechanical ventilation. So the respiratory rate and peak or plateau pressures. But, well, I have said the word respiratory rate many times. The inclusion of respiratory rate in mechanical power makes it, important.
Samantha Greenfold makes a question on which you have partly already answered, because what is the best or optimal way to minimize mechanical power if we have to increase tidal volume or respiratory rate? And for that, you have already answered.
I guess so, I think I can focus on again that
change PEEP or even change PEEP. This is the
it's really the balance between all the parameters. Sometimes if you increase PEEP, you have a better compliance because you have some recruitment, so you have a more sufficient lung, which will decrease your driving pressure, which will decrease your mechanical power. And sometimes when you increase or decrease tidal volume, this is also having an effect on the mechanical power. So it's all about the balance between everything you set, but that makes it also so complex to achieve, to have that lowest amount of mechanical power. That's what makes it so difficult, because it's different for every patient.
Again, on this topic, do you think that lung recruitment is changing the lung condition, and how this could be integrated in the mechanical power story?
Well, when we speak about lung recruitment, you can mean really recruitment with a very high amount of pressures. But when I say recruitment, it's just that you use with PEEP just a little slightly part of the lung that you can use extra with the optimal amount of PEEP. So when you can recruit some part of the lung with some more PEEP, then that will have an effect on your driving pressure, because it will decrease, and that will decrease the amount of mechanical power.
Thank you very much, Laura. Caroline is again with us, so it means that. But we have answered most of the questions.
Yeah, well, I like all those questions. Thanks to the audience.
Okay, so that's all we have time for today, everybody. Thanks to you all for being with us. And of course, a huge thanks, as always, to our two experts. Watch your inbox late next week for the link to the recording, as well as the link to answers for any questions that we didn't manage to address today. And the next webinar is scheduled for May 4th. So we look forward to seeing you then. If you're watching on YouTube and you're not already signed up for the series, you can do so in a minute using the QR code that will be displayed here. And if you're watching live, can we just ask that you please take a minute to answer the few short questions that appear on your screen when you leave this session. So thanks again for joining us. And to those of you celebrating Easter, we hope you have a lovely long weekend. Thanks and bye for now. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye all.
Happy Easter to everybody. Thank you.